also there a very inspirational talk yesterday. Tweeted 2 days ago that this will be the time when we rewrite history. Robert De Niro, I look very much forward. I hope that we as a conference rewrite history. I think Karen started to rewrite history. And when I talked to Robo and asked her what brings you here, what is your intention, she said, well, I want to rewrite the narrative of African healing. And I think that was so strong. And I don't want to say more because everything said more is, I think it's too much. I just want to invite you to come to the stage. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being here with all of your friends.
We tend to want to get to it because we understand that the stakes are high and there's a sense of agency, but by getting into it, we can actually be reapplying the same old, same old. And I'm hoping that my talk today will actually provoke you to start to think things differently as you are moving towards action. So it will be that little bug that is sitting on your butt that as you think, like, are we really thinking the same old way as we are applying our actions? So my intentions of my talk is to actually inspire, and the word inspire means to bring you back into spirit. So I'm inviting you to listen not only with your ears, but to open your hearts, open your spirits, so that you can hear what I'm trying to say, and it inspires and ignites something inside you. But also I'm here to provoke you a little bit and make you uncomfortable. And if you're feeling uncomfortable and you have no idea what to do, you are in the right place. So give yourself a round of applause.
When there was war about to erupt or when we needed to gather as a community,
community would play the drum as an invitation. It was calling us towards something. So today's drums, of course, probably we got emails to be called to this gathering. And that's what I mean about we are always evolving. But for us, the drum is not only just a tool of communicating and bring the community and allow for the community to gather, but the drum is a call to spirit to come forward. Because a lot of us who are experiencing elements or discourses in our lives are being called towards something, and that something, because of the current paradigm that we live in, there are no words to express it. It's not written in textbooks. So when we speak about issues of spirituality, we're very familiar with Eastern philosophies, but we're not familiar with other philosophies. And you might be asking yourself, but Gogo, why are you telling us about African spirituality? I mean, we are in Europe. Well, we all know, again, science has proved that the cradle of humankind is way back in Mother Africa. So we all know that we can trace our DNA back into the continent of Africa with Homo naledi. So all of us sitting in this room, this speaks to all of us. And it might not speak to you, but it might speak to a generation that comes after you. It might speak to a sibling who is struggling with some sort of disease that they've tried everything, but nothing seems to work. So that's why we need to be changing our paradigms and start to look things just not from here, but open and expand our viewpoints around how we actually understand things. So I also question, when we speak about climate change, from what paradigm are we speaking about? When we speak about sustainability and transformation, from which point of view are we looking at it? Sit with that for a minute. So where it all begins for us, because we understand that as human beings, we are also a spiritual entity. So my belief actually is that we are spiritual beings having a human experience. So as human beings who are having a human experience, we need some sort of guidance on how to navigate the complexity of the human life. So in African spirituality, actually death is not the end of life, it's the beginning of another life. So we don't die like how we say in science, energy doesn't die, it only transforms. So in African spirituality, when your body leaves this planet and it ceases to exist, your spirit goes on to live on and it joins what we call greater energy. Religion can call it God, Allah. What other names are there? A lot of other names that we know as divine or source or divine power. And I also want to challenge you, just because you don't believe in any of the things that we're going to say today, doesn't mean it doesn't exist. I come from a background of very Stonehenge, charismatic Christianity. So for years, I never believed in African spirituality because the belief in which religion taught me was that if only you believe in it, it means it does exist or it doesn't exist for you. So if you don't believe in it, it will not affect you. Look where it has found me. I'm on stage talking about being an African spiritual leader. So my belief was irrelevant. So that's also what happens when we speak about spiritual healing. People always want to attach it or connotate it to believe that you don't believe it's not going to work. So for me, I didn't believe in it, and when I got called, I was not aspiring to be a Sangoma. I actually wanted to be a scientist myself. I was a good student in chemistry, and I wanted to be a biochemist or be a chemical analyst. All those things were my aspiration. I grew up in Alexandra Township, which is northeast of Johannesburg, one of the poorest townships in South Africa, with about 800,000 population, with a township the size of Lundberg, I think. But we have about 800,000 people living in it. So we were taught from an early age that if you work very hard and you stay out of trouble and you become a good girl and you go to church and you follow everything right, your life will become right. So I followed everything. I listened to my parents. I did the right things. I went to school. I studied hard. But things still did not manifest for me, and I didn't understand why until I went to an American school for 2 years where I really struggled, and I did not struggle because my intellect capacity or my IQ failed me. It's because something was happening inside me that led me into a mental institution for 6 months. I went into a mental institution where I got diagnosed with temporal lobe epilepsy after a series of blood tests, brain scans, EEG scans, psychotherapy, psychiatry, and psychology. They were trying to figure out what was wrong with me, and I was trying to figure out what was wrong with me because at church I was probably demonic possessed, because I would go in what we call a trance state. So I would move out of this physical state and become somebody else who then would come and speak through me. So that was like an exorcist movie when I was in church. And when I was in hospital, science said it's probably after a psychotic illness. And that was what was wrong with me. And for half a year, I was on prescribed mental illness medicine. But that didn't help. And the reason I'm sharing this story is that when I look at this picture, for me, the beginning began here, and this is what crystallized change for me. Because if you look at this picture, there is cloths like this, that I'm wearing one I'm wearing. There's alcohol, you know, Germans, you love your beer. We also love our beer. In the center, there's a calabash umbohut, which is a traditional beer. It's made out of sorghum, it's fermented, so actually it's full of probiotics. I don't have a good beer, but ours is healthy. So, and there's candles, and there's bamboo, which is wild sage that we use to burn, and it has healing properties. Not only does it invite the spirit of our ancestors forward, but it's actually also medicinal. So it began here. So when my dad, at the age of 23, after I had an unexplained miscarriage, performed a ritual, and that ritual connected me to the sacredness of the relationship I had to have with my ancestors. So we call it Umsamo, and I know South Africans are watching back in South Africa because we're streaming this live. So this is not actually the shrine itself. It's a main shrine that we were facilitating a workshop in Cape Town for women, and saying let's create a woman healing center. And we thought when we speak of healing, we don't only speak of our own wounds, but we speak of generational wounds. And we know the history of Germany. We carry generational wounds, ancestral wounds, and some of us are experiencing things right now that we cannot articulate or we can't find solutions to because they are not of this time. They are ancestral wounds that we carry. And this is where the power of African spirituality comes into play, because it heals the pathology of the family wounds that might manifest itself in disease, because for us, disease is what is not at ease with the body. And what is not at ease can be something that is very spiritual, not necessarily biological, but it's manifesting itself in the biology. Because we find that a lot of people who come to us come with physical, biological symptoms of extreme migraines, that they've done anything and everything, but still nothing seems to work. They come with unexplained teeth problems, they come with fertility issues, and they've tried everything, they've tried IBS, but nothing seems to work. And when you dig and you look into it, you realize that the issues are spiritual. So our relationship with the spirit world, or with whom we call the ancestors, is very incremental, because to us they are like what roots are to a tree. When we are not deeply rooted, how do we then expect to bear fruit? And all of us here come from some sort of traditional culture, but as I said earlier on, you trace your roots back to the human cradle of, the cradle of humankind, which is Africa. So, and that's why people will say, hey man, you guys have soul, you've got spirit, we all have it. It's just that it depends on what we have been fed, and we have lost that. And in losing that spiritedness, we've lost our interconnections. We've moved away from umuntu, ubuntu, gabantu, which is I am because you are. By the way, current is an African idiom. It's not an African idiom, let me correct that. So we say umuntu, ubuntu, gabantu. Mutu, kimutu, kabatu, meaning I am because you are. So when I am thriving, I can actually impact your thriving. If I'm ailing, I'm going to impact you. So when we're looking at the health system, as much as it might sound separate or not part of this conversation, but if we are not healthy, if our health system is failing us, it's going to, if climate change continues the way that it does, is going to impact people's qualities of life back in Africa and all over the world. We understand what poverty does. So all these systems are actually interconnected. They're not separate. They are one system's health impacts the health of the other system. So it begins here and really having a solid relationship with those who have lived before us. And the reason is because we believe and we trust and we know that they are connected to an ether, to a universe that is source, that is creator. So when we are deeply connected to them, we are able to also create things that can actually bring health, well-being as human beings. Are you following me?
Woo!
So I like the woo and then we do that about Istanbul. Woo! Ah! Yo! Oh! So that's an affirmation. So we are out here with a group of Sangoma students in a forest in Bush Park Ridge, which is the Eastern Transvaal, as people would know it, but it's called Mpumalanga in South Africa. And we are there to actually harvest traditional medicine. And how we work with nature, our relationship with nature is not one way it is nature. Our relationship with nature is one way we and nature are actually one. So how we connect with nature is not only to harvest the plants and take away from nature, but is to understand that the more healthy nature is, the more healthy our forests are, and that the ecosystem and the biodiversity of the forest or the bushes that we work with, the healthier we are as a people. So how we even harvest the medicines, there's a lot of mindfulness that goes into it. We don't just jump into a forest and say, hello, we want you tree, because we've got some medicinal properties. We are very mindful of that that is a life force, and that tree has a spirit, and we want it to make us well, so there is times in which we harvest. There are days that we won't go into the forest. We speak to the forest and ask permission to the mother forest that we can enter its sacred space, that we are coming with good and well intention. So that is a level of consciousness and mindfulness that gets into the in the work that we do, because we understand that in order for that tree to give us life, we need to see it as a life force, and we cannot take it for granted. Because we don't only use nature for its plants and its medicines and yes, its animals, but we also go into it as a place of solitude. So you find a lot of people, because I work and my practice is based in the city, people as I spoke, I'll use the example of headaches because that's one of the most common things we get migraines, but it's because people are just moving from one thing to the other. We've been consumed by consumerism. We've been consumed by, if you look busy, you are hardworking. If you look busy, you are successful. So how you become validated as a human being right now is the amount of papers you are writing, you know, the amount of work you can put out. That's a lot of strain on the body, and it will manifest itself as disease. So when we go into nature, we understand that the solitude and the sacredness of nature actually is a healing aid on its own without really touching the tree or taking anything away from it. Just in that space where you can detach from the busyness and the hecticness of life, that people come and we become in prayer together, we become in partner together. I don't like saying, because some words don't exist in English of the things we do. Partner is not prayer. It's kind of like we're asking spirit to pave and make a way for us as we connect to divine energy. So when we get into those spaces, we partner and we connect to the ground, we connect to the trees, and we connect to all of it. But it's a very important space, because that's where we get our medicine from. So Sangomas are not necessarily medicinal people. So in this forest, we actually went with other types of spiritual healers called Izinyan or Amageda, meaning those are people who specialize in the medicinal plants. So they would guide us as Sangomas that this tree, you don't cut it this way, because you cut it, it impacts the tree life for the next 30 years. You come back and you find the tree. So they will tell us that actually when it's this small, you don't do anything, or you actually have to cut it when it's small so that it can bear fruit, you know, for you. So there's a lot of things that go into place. We would even put beads or coins, but kunga, So by doing that, we are actually saying that we give thanks and gratitude. And we ask that when we come tomorrow, we find you. Because there's time for you going to the forest to harvest some extra plants, and you know where the tree is, and you go back, it's not there. So that's how we know that whatever that we're working with, every living entity, the animals we work with, the trees we work with, the plants we work with, we see them as the same as us. We don't take them for granted. What do you see in this picture? What comes to mind? I don't analyze it. The first thing that comes.
Prayer.
Yes?
Prayer.
A prayer? Okay, somebody?
Intensity.
Say what, sir?
Intensity.
Intensity?
Joy.
Joy? Okay.
Sorry.
It's a lot of things. But I want to say, when I, before I speak about this picture, I want to do this. Spiritual that presents itself as mental illness. And the invitation here is that when we are working in the medical field or that somebody who is better to the colleague, grow up with a lot of things that don't make sense. And when you are weird or strange or a weirdo, it leaves some emotional scars that will stay with you until you do something about it. So I understand that when I train you as a Sangoma, it's not going to take away the pain that was caused by people bullying you and calling you a weirdo. It's not going to take away the shame that you had to experience because you were busy burping abruptly. I'm surprised my sisters are not wanting to show off today and burp. Because one of the things we do as Sangoma is we burp unannounced. Or you yawn, or I'm putting my shoes, or things that would happen that, according to societal norms, they don't fit into that box. So definitely that will cause some sort of distress that can manifest as a mental illness, but the consequence might not be mental illness. Are you following me?
Yes.
Woo.
So what I'm saying is that when you're looking at and a name actually, an ancestral name is Egeje. She's holding what we call a shoba and she's wearing all these beautiful beaded ornaments, but they're just not beads to her. These are some of the things that we use as treatment tools to make sure that she is restored into body, mind, and spiritual health so she can be a functioning human being again in society. And the gift of going through this process for us is that it restores back our dignity because we are taught that nothing is wrong with you being the way that you are. Just because you're a spiritual person and you see and you hear and you can be able to communicate with the world that people don't see, you're not a weirdo, you're a gifted child. Secondly, by us being in alignment with the entity that is asking us to go and be of service, because when we are healers, we're not only healing ourselves, we're not only healing family pathologies, but we might be healing a generational or a country's or a world's pathology in the work that we do. We know that with what we experience in the world, a little bit of gentleness, love, and care we need. Oh, I thought you were clapping hands. And what I love about the work of spirituality and the work that I do as a Sangoma is that it cuts across race, gender, because in the spirit world, those boxes do not exist. We work with you as a human being and we see your sacredness as such. Yes, this is not a good enough time to do justice to what I'm trying to articulate. So I'm just planting seeds. And remember, if you're feeling uncomfortable, you're in the right place, eh? So pat yourself on the back. So rituals are a very important part of, and I've spoken a bit about some of the rituals, because in this training you actually have to be put through the fire to transform. You know the alchemist, where transforming slowly to gold has been put into, we have fireplace, so that all the elements of nature play an incremental role for us. So what you're seeing here, and I'm not going to say in detail, because we grew up knowing that there's a power of secrecy with African rituals and practices, is actually the sacredness, because some of these things, when I share them and you're sitting in here and 2 years later you're finding yourself in Johannesburg and you're having to go or either take this practice, what it does is that it jeopardizes your experience. Because these things, we go through them, and when we go through them, we don't go through them as dinero, we go through them with the ancestral spirits that have called us to do this work. So as I share, pardon me and excuse me for the limitation of the sharing, but this is one of the processes that we do, because when people come with disease that has nothing seems to work, they have to go through the process of crossing the fire. And crossing the fire again, like I said, is not only feeding themselves, but it's feeding their families and feeding their communities and feeding their nation. So you go through the process of feeding the fire, and the last stages of going through the process is this beautiful picture where you come out of the water. It's called the water initiation. And through that initiation is washing away the old and bringing forth the new. And I'm hoping that what I'm saying here, some of the old thinking, some of the old way of being can be washed away, because the significance of water for us is that water is a purifier. water is an energizer, water is a cleanser, that sometimes only that and go through that process can we take away things that no longer serve us and be reborn anew. Inviting you to see a world that you have not seen before and to understand your own personal system and your interconnectedness of the system. Because let me use one example. You come and you realize that you've got everything in your life but things don't seem to go well. Or you come and you've got this headache that's persisting and pills, medication is not working. And we say actually what's happening with you is that you are being asked to listen and pay attention. So the rituals that we perform are both physical, but they are also psychological because we teach you an art of meditation. So when you are using the treatments which are medicinal plants, which are will feed the body, but how you work with them is not just to drink, it's the consciousness of when you're drinking, what do you say to it? When you are steaming with it, what are you speaking into it? Because when we speak, we understand that where is power? When you speak into that plant, you are actually recognizing, as I said about the life force that exists within that medicinal plant. And then you are respecting it for its life force. Because already, you know, I'm vegan, and I know how as vegan we are very like, yeah, you are like killing animals. And, but plants are also living entities. I'm vegan for that and many other reasons, and we use a lot of animals in our rituals. And I'm saying, maybe I'm here to innovate, and we're going to be cutting cabbages and making offerings of pumpkins to the other in the next 2,000 years. Who knows? Because things are evolving, and we're realizing that actually the amount of meat that we consume is killing the planet. And we still slaughter cows and we still slaughter things. Actually, should have put a picture there. That, but how we do it, we don't kill them. We're not a slaughterhouse. We recognize that that is a living entity and it's got a soul and a spirit that is willing to give of itself the same way that the tomato and the pumpkin you're about to consume for lunch has been willing to give itself to you. We recognize that in the animals that we work with. So how the animals are taken of, we would not buy from a slaughterhouse, we buy from a local farmer who we know that is taking good care of that animal, and we don't have to slaughter cows every year to perform rituals. So those are some of the assumptions people make when they look at how we do things and why we do things a certain way, because sometimes the eyes in which we're looking at things can be very deceiving. So my last statement to you is that as you're moving into action, how can you act as a way of being, not as a way of thinking? Because a lot of us in this room are thinkers, right? We are strategists, we are scientists, we're doing, I was Googling the word science, and you know, like, I think I qualify as a scientist because it says a course of study over a period of time and experiments and experiences. But a lot of us, we stay in the cognitive and not stay in the actual doing. So when we're looking at how we can act, how can we be in the doing? So that's why when we sing and drum, for us it's just not a form of entertainment, but we are embodying the work that we do through music and drumming. Because some of the people who come experiencing fits or seizures, all they need is the call of the drum to calm the spirit down. Because that spirit you are carrying with you is a spirit that was part of a vessel built in the 1900s or in the 1800s. And when you hear the drums, it knows that it's true, it's welcome, but it does not have to enforce itself onto the human body. Yeah. I'm inviting you into tapping into indigenous knowledge systems that existed, that have seemed to exist as we try to modernize, as we try to be relevant. There are things and there are ways in which we work. I shared a little bit about how we work with nature, how we do things that respect the life force. So what are some of those things? And we've got people from all over the world that we each carry a bit of indigenousness in us that we can say there is something. And for me, what is that indigenousness that we need? Is how can we remain true to the call, to the spirit that stops us from fighting each other for our differences, but seeing the joy in the diversity of who we are. Because we can spend the next couple of hours fighting over ideas, which one is wrong, rather than actually spending the next couple of hours hearing each other and saying, you think differently, but that difference might be what I need to propel me towards my action. Woo! And lastly, what I'm inviting you to as you move towards action is to interrogate and question your own thinking and your own intentions, because it's so easy for us to see the hole in the other's eye and not see it in our own. There's a saying in my language in Sipedi that says, so that means actually a man who can never see his forehead but is always poking the other man for his forehead. So when we move towards action, I think really interrogate your own thinking, your own intentions, and why are you wanting what you are wanting. And we're not going to get it all right today, but I said we are rewriting history, and everyone who is in this room is part of rewriting that history. And everyone who's in this room is part of a movement, and maybe we might not need to see it take petition, but it doesn't mean we need to stop doing what we're doing because we think that it's not enough people in the room. If only we had this one, and if only this one thought this way. Change did not begin with comfortable conversation or all us hanging around the fire. It began with some level of discomfort. So if I've created discomfort, please take it with you towards the next session. I wish I had an hour, I wish I had days, but sometimes 10 minutes is all we need to start planting the right kinds of seeds for change.
Thank you.
Half an hour later, we have time for